Okay, let's get started. Good afternoon. So for those who don't know me, I'm Denis Volkov and I'm working here at AOML and CMAS. And the title of my talk is Maelstrom of the Nordic Seas. Well, this doesn't mean I'm going to talk about something scary like shown on this picture, but this is a rather interesting phenomenon observed in the Norwegian Sea. And actually, the other title of this presentation is Eddy Dynamics in the Lofoten Basin of the Norwegian Sea. And I would like to acknowledge people I collaborated with. So first is the Arseniy Kubrekov from St. Petersburg State University. He's a postdoc there, and also Rick Lampkin. So let's go. Okay, so as a non-native speaker, I was actually it was interesting for me to know that Maelstrom actually originates from early modern Dutch and means a strong whirlpool. And actually, this term was first introduced into English by American writer Edgar Poe, when in his short story "Descent into the Maelstrom," he actually pictured a man who recounts how he survived a shipwreck and a whirlpool. And it was also, and this whirlpool was located in the Norwegian Sea, close to the Lofoten Islands. And the very same whirlpool was also mentioned by Jules Verne in his 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. And this is actually the place where Captain Nemo and his Nautilus disappeared. And although this description is very fictional and exaggerated, but the phenomenon itself is real, and it's actually called the Moskstraum and Maelstrom. I'm not sure whether my pronunciation is correct. So it is located off the Lofoten Islands in the Norwegian Sea, and it is a result of complex bathymetry and tidal currents. So the phenomenon was known for quite a long time, and back in the end of 16th century, a Swedish bishop, Olaus Magnus, pictured this maelstrom on his Carta Marina, and you see it shown here. So now let's see what present day observations tell us. So here you see the maps of drifter velocities, these three. And so these drifter velocities are obtained using somewhat different methods, but all of them, they show a very strong anticyclonic vortex located in the center of the Lofoten Basin with velocities exceeding like 30 centimeters per second. And the phenomenon appears to be a permanent feature in the Norwegian Sea. Here you see the shipborne ADCP measurements at two depths, 44 meters and 700 meters. And they also show, so this is synoptic measurements, and the velocities exceed about half meter per second. So you see a very strong anticyclonic gyre located in the center. So the vortex was discovered back in 1970s and 1980s during Russian hydrographic surveys in this region. And it was all, back then it was mentioned as a quasi-permanent phenomenon, and now it is also supported by recent satellite observations and in-situ observations and also ocean models. And the vortex represents a convective lens of warm and saline water between about 300 and 1,000 meters depth. So here this is an old figure from a paper in the Russian journal in 1995. So here you see the profile, vertical profile of geostrophic velocities in solid contour and potential density. So you see that there is a core of the vortex which is located at a depth of about 400-500 meters depth. And these are more modern observations. So this is a cross section, a zonal cross section, just which goes across the gyre, the Lofoten vortex, from paper published last year. And so this is temperature and this is salinity. And the vortex is actually associated with these isotherms and isohalines doming down right in the center. So it's been reported that the vortex is not stationary and it drifts, but there are some contradictory reports on that. So the very first mention of the vortex said that the vortex drifts cyclonically, and this is also from old Russian paper. So there are, it's based on several hydrographic surveys, and you see how the center of the vortex actually moved in a cyclonic way. But based on the model output, more recent paper showed that the vortex drift anticyclonically. So this is a question. I put a question mark, and I'm going to address this too. So now let's see what the Lofoten Basin is actually, and what its role is in the global circulation. So the Lofoten Basin is actually a topographic depression with depths up to 3,200 meters depth, right in the center. And so here you see the coast of Norway. This is the continental shelf and slope, and it's also bounded by several ridges on the other side. The circulation is governed by the Norwegian Atlantic Current, which is a continuation of the North Atlantic Current that brings warm and saline water into the Nordic Seas. Yeah, I should say the Nordic Seas is a generic term for the Greenland, Norwegian, Iceland, and sometimes also Barents Sea. So what is interesting about the Lofoten Basin is that it features a local maximum of sea surface height variability and eddy kinetic energy. And this is dominated mainly by the mesoscale signals. So you see, it looks like a hotspot of oceanic variability in this region. And the interesting, so actually, the Lofoten Basin, to the south of the Lofoten Basin, there is a Norwegian Basin, but as you see, there is no such variability. And actually, the difference is that North Atlantic Current that enters the Norwegian Basin, it is mainly constrained to the continental slope. And so all this warm and saline water is actually follows the slope, and it's not transported to the west. While in the Lofoten Basin, we see that the entire basin is actually the upper 1,000 meters is filled with Atlantic water. And this is mainly by eddies. So the Lofoten Basin is thus a major heat reservoir of the Nordic Seas. And of course, there large interactions between ocean and atmosphere take place. So the Atlantic water is getting transformed. So it loses heat to the atmosphere. It mixes with the ambient water masses. And so the basin plays potentially an important role in the transformation of this Atlantic water on its way to the Arctic Ocean, and thus plays an important role in the meridional overturning circulation. Okay, so because of the conservation of potential vorticity, we know that in the Northern Hemisphere, all the topographic depressions are associated with cyclonic circulation. And actually, because of high eddy activity in the Lofoten Basin, it is so the surface cyclonic circulation is hardly observable with the synoptic surveys. But at mid-depths, cyclonic circulation has been observed with Argo floats. And you see this picture based on the Argo floats velocities. Okay, so this should be an animation which turned out not working. But here I was showing the mesoscale variability of sea surface height. So this is just mesoscale with intranial and seasonal variability removed. And you would see like a lot of eddies generated by the Norwegian current and that move around the Lofoten Basin following basically the bottom topography contours. And back in 2013, so we published a paper where we actually estimated the eddy propagation velocities in the basin, and you see there is a clear cyclonic propagation path with velocities reaching about 3 kilometers per day. And we also decomposed this mesoscale variability into complex. Yes, and you see this, there is a cyclonic. There is no any indication of anticyclonic movement of eddies there. There is only cyclonic. So we also decomposed this variability into complex empirical orthogonal functions, and we found that most of variance in the center of the basin, so where the Lofoten vortex is located, is mainly explained by two modes. which we call, there is a dipole mode and a quadrupole mode. And if the animations were working, you would see how these modes, these patterns, they rotate around cyclonically. All right, so there are two hypotheses for the Lofoten vortex formation. So the main question is why it is there. And first is the this hypothesis was the first one that appeared in the literature, and it's related to winter convection. So during winter, so the surface water cools down, and this cooled surface water penetrates into the deeper layers. And this water is actually, the sinking water is actually warmer than the water below, and it sinks just because its salinity is higher because of the Atlantic water that comes in. So strengthening of this thermohaline anomaly, which with the maximum at about 400-500 meters depth, leads to shrinking of the vortex length and increases its anticyclonic vorticity. And here you see this is a map actually showing October climatology of sea surface temperature from MODIS and then geostrophic velocity from altimetry. And so here you see this Lofoten vortex, and you see that at the surface it has lower temperatures than water around it. And finally, the second hypothesis is related to eddy mechanism. So what it says? It says that the Norwegian Atlantic current generates a lot of eddies, and then these eddies, they are attracted to the center of the Lofoten basin, and then they merge with the Lofoten vortex and thus reinforce it. And this is actually the major mechanism proposed that maintains the vortex over a long period of time. And here you see the time longitude diagrams. So I should say that this hypothesis is primarily based on model experiments. And here you see eddy propagation, zonal eddy propagation from the model, and this from altimetry. But as I showed you a little bit earlier, it's not purely zonal propagation, but it is rather a cyclonic propagation of eddies around the center of the basin. So the eddies actually that are pinched, that are generated by the Norwegian Atlantic current, they basically move cyclonically and then spiral towards the center of the basin. Okay, so the main objectives of this work were to revisit this problem of the Lofoten vortex formation using numerical simulations at different horizontal resolutions, with the main goal to investigate the role of eddies in the dynamics of the Lofoten vortex. Then, benefiting from a high resolution experiment, we wanted to estimate kinematic properties of the Lofoten vortex and other eddies in the basin, determine what processes drive the variability of the vortex strength, and then, because there is a clear link between the Norwegian Atlantic current and the Lofoten vortex, we wanted to investigate this dynamical relationship. So how variability of that Norwegian Atlantic current influences the variability of the Lofoten vortex strength. Okay, so for this we used numerical experiments based on regional MIT GCM setup. So this is the model domain. So this is basically, this model is a segment of a global ECHO2 cube sphere model, and this is basically just one phase of that model that has the Arctic Ocean. So actually this model was, this model experiments were performed for multiple purposes, so it can be used for other reasons. But here we just focused on this small region which envelops the Lofoten basin. So this is a volume conserving configuration, has 50 vertical levels. Then the model was started from initial conditions that are from World Ocean Atlas 2009. The lateral conditions were taken from ECHO2 global optimized solution. And the forcing which we used was JRA Japanese reanalysis 25. So the model is also coupled to sea ice model. So what we did, we ran three experiments at different resolutions. So one is 18 kilometer run. So the mean grid spacing is 18 kilometer. Then a run with the mean grid spacing of 9 kilometers. And so the highest resolution is 4 kilometers. And the period of model run is 21 years from 1992 to 2012. So this picture illustrates sea surface height averaged over the first week of the experiment 18, so 18-kilometer resolution. So this is basically shows the initial conditions, because this is the average over the first week of integration. So this is basically initial conditions from World Ocean Atlas. And you see that in the initial conditions, so there is a flow that goes along the sea surface height contours associated with the Norwegian Atlantic current, but there is nothing really happening in the Lofoten Basin. So now, to study the vortex itself and other eddies, first we need to identify them. So to identify the eddies and track them, we use this automated eddy identification method called winding angle. So the principle of this method is as follows. So basically, Lagrangian particles are released at every grid point of a stationary velocity field. So we take just one snapshot of velocities, and we use velocities at 95 meters depth to minimize the effect of Ekman currents. So we release these Lagrangian particles, and then we calculate the total winding angle. So the particle is advected by the flow, and then we calculate all these angles, we sum them up, and we obtain this winding angle. So when this winding angle exceeds 35 degrees, then this point is considered to be situated on a closed streamline, so that it belongs to an eddy. And then a cluster of these points would compose an eddy, for example. So here you see a snapshot of eddy positions. So this red shows anticyclones and blue cyclones. And here you see an example single eddy trajectory that originates around the Norwegian Atlantic current and then starts its cyclonic propagation towards the center of the basin. And here you see the trajectory of the Lofoten vortex itself. So you see how it moves actually cyclonically, not anticyclonically, but cyclonically. And so as I said, we use model velocities 95 meters depth. We also identify and track individual eddies, and we compute the number and probability of anticyclonic eddies and cyclonic eddies. Probability is basically the portion of time from 0 to 1 when an eddy of a certain sign is situated over a particular grid point. And we also compute radius or area of an eddy and orbital velocity of eddies. Okay, so let's see the results. And here you see the mean sea surface height and mean velocity at 15 meters depth for three experiments. So this is experiment 18, experiment 09, and experiment 04. So here you see that there is no Lofoten vortex at all. So basically, this is the 15-year average, and you see that this average is not very much different from the initial condition. So basically, we have like a coherent flow to the northeast, north-northeast, across the entire Lofoten vortex. So when we double the resolution, what we see, what's happening is the formation of a cyclonic circulation cell over the basin itself. And this cyclonic circulation becomes even stronger in the 4-kilometer experiment. And what we see here is that there is already a weak Lofoten vortex in 9-kilometer experiment and a stronger vortex in 4-kilometer experiment. Okay, so this graph shows the relative vorticity at 15 meters depth, average over area with depths greater than 2,700 meters. So this is basically the central part of the Lofoten vortex. Not actually the central. This isobath basically. So this is basically the major part of the Lofoten basin. So the black line shows the experiment 18. So you see that the average vorticity is very low. So it goes cyclonic or anticyclonic. And then in a high resolution run 9-kilometer experiment, there is already a steady cyclonic flow over the basin. And then in the 4-kilometer run, we have a almost all the time. There is a cyclonic circulation. So this is a background cyclonic flow over which the anticyclonic Lofoten vortex resides. And so the variability is much stronger in the red because of the eddies, because this model experiment produces more eddies that drift to the center of the basin, and that's why there are a lot of wiggles in the red curve. So what you can also see that the spin-up time to establish the cyclonic circulation is very short. It's about 1 year. And so let's see how actually this is the 4 kilometer experiment and the absolute velocity at 15 meters depth. So it starts from initial conditions, then eddies are formed. And so this is the time mean position of the Lofoten vortex. And you see how the first eddy came here. And so look also how eddies are merging actually. So there'll be several merges during the animation. And so you see this merging occurred and then the vortex actually accelerated. Okay, let's move on. So here you see the maps of eddy kinetic energy from satellite altimetry and from 3 experiments. So satellite altimetry shows a clear eddy kinetic energy maximum located in the center of the basin associated with the Lofoten vortex. So eddy kinetic energy is very low, no maximum associated with the Lofoten vortex in experiment 18, and we will not consider this experiment any further. So in experiment 09, most of eddy kinetic energy is concentrated along the Norwegian Atlantic slope current over here, while experiment 04 shows actually the best representation of eddy kinetic energy in the center of the Lofoten vortex. So what I should also point out is that there is a difference, clear difference with altimetry. So altimetry doesn't actually reproduce, doesn't show this eddy kinetic energy maximum along the slope. And as I think actually, this is a problem mainly of altimetry, not of the model, because if we look at other studies based on drifter measurements, so you clearly see there is a large eddy kinetic energy located at exactly the same area. And actually when I took our weekly model output and I low pass filtered it with a 1 year 1 month window, I actually got a big reduction of eddy kinetic energy. So my I suggest that altimetry data, basically the spatial and temporal resolution, is not just enough to capture that those high frequency signals that dominate eddy kinetic energy along the slope. All right. So here you see the vertical sections of temperature, salinity, and meridional velocity across this section that goes across the Lofoten vortex. So experiment 09, as we saw, it reproduces a relatively weak Lofoten vortex, while experiment 4 kilometer experiment shows the best, it best simulates the Lofoten vortex. And you see that there is a core of velocities located at about 500 meters depth, showing velocities of up to 20 centimeters per second. And so for the following, we will use only experiment 4 as the best experiment for simulating the Lofoten vortex. Okay, so now I'm showing you the probability. So this is a probability of anticyclones and cyclones in the Lofoten basin. And so these are anticyclones and these are cyclones. So this is, as I said, this is a portion of time when an eddy of certain sign is situated over a particular grid point. So you see there is a maximum. So this is an anticyclonic Lofoten vortex. The maximum is associated with the vortex. And then there is a path, basically a path of elevated probability values. That's were anticyclone generated by the Norwegian Atlantic current propagate, and then they reach the Lofoten vortex. The largest probability of cyclones is basically observed at the periphery of the Lofoten vortex, and this mainly related to the velocity shear between the Lofoten vortex itself and the background cyclonic flow. And here you see the scatter plot. So the horizontal line shows the radius of eddies, and the vertical line is the vertical axis is the maximum orbital velocity. And it is showing for the anticyclonic eddies and for cyclonic eddies. And what you can see that anticyclonic eddies are generally larger, they have a bigger radius, and they are stronger. So with the velocities reaching here, you see them above 40 centimeters per second. All right, here I'm showing you the mean eddy radius and eddy orbital velocities. So eddy radius is related to eddy area, and you see that the maximum radius is again associated with the Lofoten vortex. Large eddies that are generated by Norwegian Atlantic current, they propagate along this path, and so they are large and they are the strongest too. So here you see that this is basically the areas where the largest and strongest eddies are formed. So what we also did, we tracked, as I showed before, we tracked the locations of the center of the Lofoten vortex of its core. And here you see this magenta trajectory. So this is the trajectory of the Lofoten vortex center. Then the background shows the time. So this is the line, this is the time mean boundary of the Lofoten vortex core. And the color shows the percentage of time over which the Lofoten vortex is present in a particular box. So you see that this is like the most likely position of the vortex. So it just goes around cyclonically, but mostly it is found over here. And here you see the strength of the vortex expressed as the relative vorticity. So it's with a minus sign because it's anticyclonic. So you see there is a clear interannual variability. And what was interesting that our model results, they correspond pretty well to results obtained recently from altimetry data. So this curve, the red curve, shows the time series of the area weighted mean eddy kinetic energy. And you can clearly see the maximums that we have in 2002-2003 that as well corresponds to this maximum. So showing that our model actually captures the right physics. And the magenta lines show the intensifications of the Lofoten vortex after it merges with incoming anticyclonic eddies. So these are two examples that I will show you on the next slide. So this is again the vorticity of the Lofoten vortex, so its strength. So it becomes stronger, then vorticity becomes more negative. And here, these are the snapshots of velocity shown by arrows and relative vorticity shown by color. So the Lofoten vortex is marked over here. And so this is the first date, then a week later, and then this 2 weeks later. And the same for this plot. And what you see that there is a clear intensification of the Lofoten vortex after 2 weeks time, but just in between them, there is a weakening of the vortex. So when the merging occurs, the vortex initially weakens. And we think that there are two possible reasons for that. So first is that energy, some energy is spent on the formation of an exterior circulation cell between the two merging edges. And the second is because it's algorithm related, basically. It's because the area over which vorticity is calculated includes the incoming eddy. So the total vorticity becomes smaller. Okay, so because as I showed you, on the vertical velocity profile, so the Lofoten vortex contains actually a strong barotropic component, so the anticyclonic velocity near the bottom are quite large, about 5 centimeters per second. And based on this, we actually computed the barotropic vorticity balance over this box that encompasses actually the area within which the Lofoten vortex drifts. And so here, this is the barotropic vorticity balance equation. So these are the advection. The first term is the advection of the relative vorticity gradient. Then we have advection of the planetary vorticity gradient. Then the vortex stretching term, the topographic term, so the and the wind stress curl, and D is dissipation. So this graph shows actually the time change of the relative vorticity averaged over here, and in blue, and then the red shows the sum of all these terms besides dissipation. And you see that there is a very good balance. So basically, the flow can be considered as non-dissipative over there. And then these graphs show the curves. So basically, the blue shows the time change of the relative vorticity. And here you see only the advection of the relative vorticity gradient and advection of the planetary vorticity gradient. And here there are correlation coefficients. And what you can see that basically the advection of the relative vorticity gradient is the most important term. And we can decompose it into the contributions by the mean flow and by the time variable flow. And the result is that the most important term is this one. So this is the advection of the planetary vorticity gradient by EDIS, so which has the highest correlation. So the correlation between this term and the time change of the relative vorticity is 0.7. So the conclusion is that the advection of the relative vorticity gradient anomaly by eddy flow makes the major contribution. So now we can actually look at what boundary is the most important for advecting this relative vorticity. So we have northern, western, eastern, and southern boundaries. And so this is the decomposition of the advection of the relative vorticity gradient. So it appears that the flow is almost non-divergent. So the last term over here is negligible because it's an order of magnitude smaller than the other terms. And here you see the the time series. So this is the relative vorticity versus each of these four remaining terms. And the conclusion is that the northern and western boundaries are the most important for the advection of the relative vorticity gradient, so which is shown by these correlation coefficients. So the correlation coefficients are 0.4 and 0.4 for both, for the northern and for the western boundary. All right, so now I'm coming already to the end of the presentation. So now we wanted to establish a relationship between the variability of the Norwegian Atlantic current and the strength of the Lofoten vortex. So for this, we considered actually three boxes. So the first, the black box, is the location where the Norwegian Atlantic current in the Lofoten basin has the largest velocities. And this is actually where the eddies start, the formation of eddies begins. And the largest box showed the area where most eddies, but just formed, they start propagating westward following the bottom topography. And this box in the center, this is basically the location of the Lofoten vortex. So now what we did, we correlated the velocity of Norwegian Atlantic slope current along slope velocity in this box with So we compared the velocities that we get from altimetry, from the model, and we correlated them with wind curl averaged over the Norwegian Sea. So you see here that there is a very nice correspondence between the velocities from altimetry and from the model, showing again that the model does a good job. And there is a significant correlation between the velocity, the strength of the Norwegian Atlantic current and the wind curl averaged over the Norwegian Sea on both the seasonal and interannual time scales. And this is actually a correlation between the MERA wind curl and the absolute geostrophic velocities from altimetry shown here. So you see that the largest correlation exceeding 0.4, which is the significance level here, they are associated with a long slope currents, especially here, strongest correlation. So this is actually the box, the black box over here. So this is the Norwegian Atlantic slope current that starts from forming eddies that propagate to the center of the basin. And here we have the largest correlation. So this correlation pattern also suggests that when we have a strengthening of cyclonic atmospheric circulation over the Norwegian Sea, so that in this case we have a so that means that the water is pushed away from the center and actually pushed towards the boundaries. So there are two effects. There is a barotropic effect and a baroclinic effect on strengthening the current. So we have more waters going onshore on the shelf, and then this increases the sea level across the shelf sea level gradient. And there is also deepening of isopycnals near over the continental slope that generates and intensifies the baroclinic current. Okay, so now here I'm showing you the so this is basically the number of the area occupied by anticyclonic eddies, then the number of anticyclonic eddies, the black curve area is red, and the Norwegian Atlantic slope current is in blue, and this is this for the seasonal cycle. So we see that there is a negative correlation between these quantities, and this can be actually explained that it requires some time. So when the current intensifies, and it takes about 4 months so for the eddies to be generated and to be separated from the Norwegian Atlantic slope current, that they are already identifiable with our algorithm. But then looking at the interannual time scales, so here we see the total vorticity of eddies in red over this large box, then the average orbital velocity of eddies, and again the time change of the Norwegian Atlantic slope current velocity on the interannual time scale. So we see that there is a correlation between these quantities, and so when the Norwegian Atlantic slope current intensifies, so with some time lag, there is an eddies that are present in that large box, they strengthen. So there is a lag correlation with a lag of about 10 months between the Norwegian Atlantic slope current and the mean orbital velocity of anticyclonic eddies. And this also means that this is actually the strength of anticyclonic eddies that makes the most important contribution to the total vorticity of eddies in the region. It's not the number of eddies, because we check the number and it doesn't work. So this is basically the strength of eddies, its orbital velocities. And now comparing this to the strength of the Lofoten vortex, so here you, the red curve shows the average orbital velocity of the Lofoten vortex. Then the black is the average orbital velocity of anticyclonic eddies, not related to the vortex, but located in that large box. And again, the blue is the interannual variability of the Lofoten of the Norwegian Atlantic slope current. And you see that there is a lag correlation between all of them. So we have a strengthening of Norwegian Atlantic current, then eddies present in that large box becomes stronger. So the current generates eddies, strong eddies. These eddies move to that box. So we have this black curve showing that. And then all these eddies, or some of them, they undergo different transformation. They can merge with each other, so they can dissipate. But some of them, mostly the strongest of them, they reach the Lofoten vortex, they merge with it, and then they can intensify it. And that we see how the intensification of the Lofoten vortex follows those maxima. And actually, the time lag between the intensification of the Norwegian Atlantic slope current and the Lofoten vortex is about 2 years. So this is the summary and conclusions of my presentation. So first we showed that the Lofoten vortex is formed in high resolution runs, and it is best represented by 4 kilometer experiment. These experiments actually provide an experimental evidence of the importance of eddies for the formation and variability of the vortex and also its stability. So we showed that the vortex is maintained by anticyclonic eddies that are usually stronger and more frequent than cyclonic eddies. When I was showing you the Bartisti balance, I didn't mention that the vortex stretching term over that box doesn't actually contribute much. So this means that the fluxes, ASC fluxes, do not really matter. But this may not be true because this is just average for the box where the vortex resides. It's not for the vortex itself. So if you were able to separate the vortex from the rest, that would be a better estimate, of course. So, and also that the variability of the vortex is mainly driven by the advection of the relative vorticity gradient by eddies, and we show that variability of the vortex is linked to the Norwegian Atlantic slope current strength, and that transfer of energy from the current to the Lofoten vortex takes about 2 years. So thank you very much, and this is actually was published last year in a paper in Deep Sea Research, and we submitted another paper on the NGRL. So, thank you.
Have you done some diagnostics in potential vorticity?
No, that's what we did actually. That's the.
Do you have the budget then for the PV of individual vortices?
No, that. No,
we didn't. Where the sources and things can be on individual eddies?
No, that's we didn't do that yet. So maybe that's a way to proceed.
So how does this fit? Why is important to study this eddy variability in the Lofoten of the Lofoten vortex in the context of the large scale circulation? Does this impact the large scale, or by studying the variability here you can tell that the large scale is changing?
Well, that's an interesting question actually. It's not easy to address, but this is definitely, I mean, there is definitely an importance of this region for the large scale circulation, because the Lofoten basin is a transit region for the, as I said, the Norwegian of Atlantic water that goes to Arctic Ocean, and this is a large heat reservoir. So because there is a large eddy variability, that heat is taken away from the Norwegian current and brought to the center of the Lofoten basin. And actually the Lofoten vortex itself is where, as you saw on the temperature and salinity profile, so this is where the thickness of the Atlantic water is the maximum. So this vortex plays an important part in, you know, transforming this water, mixing it, and this vortex and other eddies, they should impact somehow, you know, the Norwegian Atlantic current itself and the transport of heat by this current.
So I may have missed it, but so mm-hmm. What is the next step for you in this step?
Well, the next step is probably to, so what we are thinking to do is to apply this eddy identification in 3D, three-dimensional, so that by doing this we can actually look at three-dimensional structure of eddies and track them in 3D, and also so estimate how much heat they can actually carry and supply to the center of the basin and take away from the Norwegian current. So that's one way to proceed.
Then is perhaps a question. First one is, you compare the statistics that you obtained from Edis from the model with those obtained from Matildrum. And the second question is, one of the figures you show, you, if I get it right, that the barotropic component is pushing water towards the coast, right? Increasing sea level in that part.
Okay.
But the plot, if the plot was showing that, it wasn't higher, closer to the coast. Is that for a particular region or?
Which plot do you mean? You mean the correlation map that I showed?
Yes.
So the correlation map shows high correlations. Let me return. I remember your first question. So this plot shows actually high correlations that are concentrated along slopes. So when we have like cyclonic wind intensifying, cyclonic curl, and so all this water is pushed not just towards the coast, but towards the coast as well. So water is pushed onshore, and so that increases the gradient, the cross slope gradient. But also because of this, we have a deepening of isopyc knolls, and that intensifies the paracline current there. So was it the answer?
Maximum correlation is along the slope.
Along the slope. Yeah, yeah. So the wind curl doesn't really matter for what's going on over here, because this is highly eddy active region, so there are, you know, it's very chaotic. So, but what's happening along the slope, that's correlated with the wind, and that's driven by the wind mainly. That's been also reported in previous studies, although they mainly address the seasonal cycles, seasonal variability. So on the seasonal time scale, the Norwegian Atlantic current strength is dominated by wind. And so the first question you asked about whether we compared our eddy statistics with altimetry. Well, yes, we did in a way, because some of this has been published already. So for example, the radius of the Lofoten vortex itself, the radius, the strength, as I showed, but also you should mind that altimetry doesn't really do a good job in resolving eddies in this region. So it does resolve strong eddies like the Lofoten vortex and large eddies, but it totally misses the smaller eddies.
How large are the cyclonic eddies?
Cyclonic eddies are generally smaller, and you know, as I showed on the scatter plot, they have radiuses. Yeah, here. Yeah, so you see their radiuses. They can be large, but that's also, but they're weak. They're smaller and weak, even weaker usually. Yeah, and as I showed, they are mostly observed on the periphery of the Lofoten vortex, so where you have this shear of the velocity.
You see any pairs?
Yeah, yeah, that takes place as well. Yeah, like this.
Dennis, let's see if I can do this without following back to my question. I'm sorry.
Mm-hmm.
Excuse me for being ignorant about this area a little bit. How far? I mean, how does the vortex location relate to where we're getting the deep water formation going on in this region? Because we're typically getting all of our waters that will ultimately become overflow waters in the area somewhere. Where is that relative to where the vortex is?
Yeah, good question actually. Well, because you know, traditionally we consider that this is the Greenland basin, right? That's where the deep water formation takes place. And so the Lofoten basin is a neighboring region.
Okay.
So let me come back to one of the few slides. And that's actually still a question, I think, how You know, how important is the all processes in the Lofoten vortex related to eddy activity? How important they are for deep water formation? Yeah, that's a question. I mean, let's think it's an active research. Yeah, that's still unclear. Yeah, so this is the Greenland Sea, right? So the Greenland Basin, that's where the deep water formation takes place, and this is the Lofoten vortex. So they're separated by this ridge.
And how shallow is that ridge?
That's about, let me see, that's about like 2,000 meters.
So it's deeper, deeper than the sills for
Yeah.
Water is able to mix across that.
Yeah, correct. So, yeah, this is the Mon Ridge over here.
So is it really the ridge or the current that is on that ridge that prevents those eddies from getting out? They are trapped by topography or they?
Well, actually, yeah, they're trapped by topography because they follow the topographic contours. And so here you have, on the other side of the Mon Ridge, you have the cyclonic circulation within the Greenland Basin itself. And so you have this. Then there is also a question whether there is a continuation of the Norwegian Atlantic current as a baroclinic branch of this current. So I think that, you know, what I showed you in the this question I'm also discussing with people who construct mean dynamic topographies, because what I see in the model, it's actually different from what you can see from available mean dynamic topographies, either from Aviso or from Delft Technical University, because they do not actually resolve this cyclonic circulation cell over there. And just yesterday I was corresponding with Per Knudsen, who does the topographies from. And so they were quite interested in that. And this is also a question whether, you know, this cyclonic circulation cell, because it's not, as I said, it's hardly observable because of the eddies. With synoptic observations, you will not see them, but see the circulation, but in the model it's there. So that's a question whether it's real, or maybe the model is too barotropic, I don't know. And the flow just follows topography. There are drifters, yeah. That's what I showed, yeah. But actually, speaking about drifters, so this figure that was, you know, it was from our publication back in 2013, and here you do not see any cyclonic flow. So that was from the drifter base available at that time, and I think it's just, yeah, it's only until 2010. But this one, this was already, this is from RIGS data, actually. And here you already have some indication of possible cyclonic flow. And actually, the most modern mean dynamic topography from Aviso, from CLS, that already, this topography already has the anticyclonic vortex, the Lofoten vortex, and there is also kind of indication that in some parts of the basin there is a cyclonic circulation. So the topography has become better, but the mean dynamic topography has become better. This is mainly because there are more drifter data available, there are more observations, and the reason.
Now I'll have to go read that Edgar Allan Poe story. I've read many of them, but not that one.
Yeah.
Very good. That was a nice
yeah,
intro.
Yeah, me too. I actually found out.
Did you go back and read it?
Yeah, yeah. I listened to it in the car.
Okay. Very interesting, very nice.
Thank you. Did I do it right? I mean, did I switch it off?
I don't know.